Never happen again.
Well, good morning. So we're getting ready to start a series on listening, and I was meeting with one of my pastor friends, Seth, that's at church in Sebastian that we help sponsor, and he said, "You realize, Eric, you should not be doing a sermon on listening, right?" Yeah, I know. But here's the truth, no matter where you're at, you might be here and people may have told you that you are an awesome listener. But no matter who we are, we all need to work on listening. And so I hope in the next few weeks to give you some ideas and some thoughts from Scripture, not only about listening to God, or excuse me, about listening to others, but also listening to God. But with that in mind, and with communication in mind, I want to tell you a joke. A couple of redneck hunters, always good to have a redneck joke because it lets me scratch my belly. A couple of redneck hunters are out in the woods when one of them falls to the ground. He doesn't seem to be breathing, and his eyes are rolled back in his head. The other redneck starts to panic. Then he takes out his cell phone and he calls 911. He frantically blurts out to the operator, "My friend Bubba is dead. What can I do?" The operator, trying to calm him down, says, "Take it easy. I can help. Just listen to me and follow my instructions. First, let's make sure he's dead." There's a short pause, and then the operator hears a loud gunshot. The redneck comes back in the line and says, "Okay, now what?" So listening is important. Now you're groaning with that joke, but all of you will be telling it at work tomorrow. Every single one of you will be telling it at work. So I'm going to give you a few statistics to get started in this series, just to give you some ideas. We're going to set the table, and so be a little patient with me. But I want to show you, if you didn't know, I want to show you why this is important. All right? Research shows that men only use half their brain to listen, while women engage both sides of their brain. Does that surprise any? Is anybody in here shocked at that study? And now, men, I'm going to tell you something already, because a guy already said it to me, that he's already said to his wife, "See, honey, that's why, no excuses, right? That means you have to learn to listen twice as hard, right?" Second, your words, as you noticed in that video, only convey about 7% of what you're trying to say. That's why some churches, even in smaller churches, are starting to go to video so you can see the pastor's face, even if you're sitting in the back, because words only convey 7%. The rest is through facial expressions and tone of voice. Like when your wife says to you, "No, no, it's okay." It's not okay. Just so you know. All right. "Do whatever you want" does not mean do whatever you want. Let me give you just a few tips for those of you who are young and married. All right. We listen to people at a rate of about 125 to 250 words a minute. Listen to this. But we think at between 1,000 and 3,000, I think that's ADD people, words a minute. Here's what that means. While I'm talking, you are thinking about much more than what I'm saying. And some of you have no idea what I'm saying because you're thinking about other things. I'm going to talk about some thoughts that we have in just a minute. Less than 2% of people have had any formal education on how to listen. By the way, I notice when I'm talking about listening, this is the quietest that this church has ever been, because you're all like, "I'm going to learn to listen. What did he say?" So how many of you have had a class in listening or a training at work on how to listen? Anybody in here? Okay, more than I thought. And some of you, because you came to last service, you're raising your hand. Doesn't count. All right. Images tend to go in long-term memory. That's one of the reasons we use videos and other things here. And words live in short-term memory, which means that most of you, before you get home, will have no idea what I talked about today. But you'll remember a story I told. There's nothing wrong with that. Okay, here's an important one. Listening to complaining, or what we sometimes call nagging, for 30 minutes or more can actually cause damage to part of your brain that handles problem-solving skills. So when you look at your spouse and you say, "You're killing me," it literally is true. You're actually destroying part of their brain. Now, for those of you who are complainers, and some of you know who you are, most people who are complainers, by the way, don't know they're complainers. They think, "I just express my opinion." Okay? If you're one of those who right now you're thinking, "I'm opinionated," you're a complainer. All right, so just write that down. All right, and if it's your spouse, you can go ahead and elbow them right now. Okay, So here's what this means. Because we have such a negative reaction to constant complaining, if you're a complainer, people will not want to be around you. It's not that they don't love you or care about you, but the danger in us is that if our conversation is constantly correction, if our primary conversation is fixing someone, then people are not going to be around. And here's the deal. In marriage, what happens over time, if you're not careful, is that will become your primary communication to your spouse, to your children, to your in-laws, right? And so you have to begin to look at that and look at your speech and say, am I killing them? Am I destroying their brain? Now, here's one for work, okay? They surveyed a bunch of corporate bosses, and here's what they discovered, and I think it was Forbes that did this study. The ability to communicate, so that means talking and listening, understanding what people are saying, being able to do something with it. Ready for this? The most important fact in making promotions. It's more important than ambition, more important than education, and even more important than hard work. Haven't you ever worked with somebody who was a great worker, but they couldn't get along with anybody else? You with me? And so if you're going to learn and grow, even in your workplace, you and I have to learn how to listen, how to understand and do something with the information. So as we talk about listening, I'm going to kind of go to the scriptural side of things. We're going to talk about what the Bible says and hopefully give you some really practical things, especially if you're like me and you tend to be distracted. What? Right? This will help you. All right. Jesus said this in Mark chapter 12, talking about the greatest commandment. He said this: love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and all your strength. And then he said, the second command is like it: love your neighbor as yourself. There's no commandment greater than these. And so Jesus equates these two commands, loving God, which includes loving people. The truth is, if you and I don't listen to people, we're not loving them. And love is spelled T-I-M-E. And that means focused attention. That means putting your device down and being able to pay attention. We're not even always good at loving God and listening to God because we get so busy and so distracted. So this year, if you're going to develop one habit that'll make a difference in your life, I want to encourage you to learn how to get still and listen to God. To spend time in the Bible and say, God, speak to me. If you will do that one habit this year, it won't just change that one habit. It will change all of your listening. It will change so many habits in your life as you allow God's word to sink into your life and change you. Now, some of you are struggling right now, even listening to me, because you've got three kind of things going on in your head. Number one, you as I'm talking, you're aggravated because you think you're the only one who does anything. You've got kind of the martyr voice. I work so hard and these other people just don't. And you're struggling even as we're sitting here. Others of you are struggling because somebody else is hurting and you think your job is to fix them. And so as we're sitting there, you're thinking of who you can help. And your brain, and that 3,000 words a minute thought, is thinking about that person. Or you're here today and you are aggravated with somebody. You think they don't deserve acceptance. They don't deserve to be loved. They haven't earned it. All three of those thoughts, and we have them over and over, those are three of the main thoughts that we struggle with when dealing with people. Those things will keep us from really listening to other people. We will put those up before we ever even hear what they say to us. So let's look, first of all, how do I tune out the noise to hear God? Can we turn my mic down just a little? It's just a little too loud for me. Is that better? You guys don't care. You're good. Okay. So we're going to talk about the story. In Mark chapter 4, Jesus tells a story about a farmer. And I meant to bring a bag of seed, especially after I talked about visuals. But we talked about a farmer who has a bag. And by the way, back then when they planted seeds, they would just spread them. Okay? So they'd go out in the field and spread them. And so this is a story Jesus tells about a farmer spreading seeds in the beginning of chapter 4. And here's what's really funny about this. The disciples are all standing there with Jesus, and I can see them. They are standing there nodding and saying, yep, what he's saying is true. It's really good. You people need to listen, you know. And, you know, they're kind of there on his side and helping with things and taking the collection. And by the way, Jesus took collection. Did you know that? And all this kind of stuff. And so they're doing all of that. And the Bible says, then they get in private. And the disciples say, okay, we don't know what that story's about. So, and by the way, it happens over and over. And Jesus kind of, and there's a few times Jesus looks at him like, how are you really going to learn anything if you don't even get that one? You know? And so Jesus then explains the story. So we're going to pick up from the explanation and Jesus talking about what it means about the farmer spreading the seeds. So the first part of that is the idea of tuning out distractions. Mark 4:15. Some people are like seeds along the path where the word is sown. As soon as they hear it, Satan comes and takes it away, the word that was sown in them. And this word for takes away here in the Greek is a really cool word. It's the idea of sail away. Remember the old song? Come sail away, come sail away, come sail away with me. I said, right? And they say 80s songs, they say the same thing 400 times and then have a guitar solo, right? That's how you know an 80s song. If you're wanting to identify, Ricky, you're wanting to identify an 80s song? They'll repeat the words 40 times and then wee. Oh, come sail away, come, and then repeat it again, and then all day you find yourself going, come sail away. Some of you haven't heard that song in 20 years, and you're in your back of your mind right now, you're going, come sail away with me. I sing it. You don't even know the rest of the song, you just sing that over and over. Alright, so this is what happens to our brains, though, all the time. It's the idea that we hear something, we read God's word, we come to church, and we hear God's word, and we're even sitting in church, and our mind suddenly sails away. This is what it looks like at your house. You walk into the kitchen, you go, I'm going to get a... Or if you're like me, you put your laundry in the washing machine, get it all, you push start, and you go along your way, and you think, I got to remember 45 minutes to take that out. And then what happens? Come sail away, come sail away, come sail... Right? So then the next morning you wake up, oh no, I forgot my clothes, and you go back, and so you redo it, because you're not going to wear sour clothes, so you redo it, and you redo the washer, and you put it back in, and you go, I'm going to remember this time, because it's a new day. And then the next morning you go, where are my pants? Oh no. Come sail away, come sail away, come sail... Right? Because what happened? You were distracted, and most likely by something that didn't matter. Something that was unimportant. We do it all the time. We do it while we're driving. Did you know most of your driving is by habit? So a lot of you don't even remember driving here. If you've come here more than a few times, you actually don't remember driving here this morning because you weren't paying attention. You're just, come sail away. You were thinking of something else. And we do that all the time, and here's the problem. We cannot listen to God if we don't take time to focus, to say, God, can I hear what you're saying? So here's what I want you to do. I want you to begin to pray during your day. God, would you help me to be still in the moment? Especially when a distraction comes, especially when a difficulty comes, especially when a trial comes, to say, God, you knew about what's happening. You knew my flight would be delayed. You knew about the difficulty I would have. You knew about this situation coming up. Lord, would you help me to learn what you want me to learn? And would you help me to do what you want me to do? That's much better than worry. Jesus even looks at the disciples and says, you can't add anything to your life by worry. I mean, you can add a heart attack and gray hair. Right? But you can't add anything to your life by worry. And yet we worry all the time when we should say, whoa, God, what do you want me to learn in this moment? And what do you want me to do in this moment? Number two, we need to learn to tune out this victim mentality. I'm going to talk about where I got that idea from in the Greek. And our struggles. Jesus said, other seeds, so you can see the farmer, he keeps going out, and it's in rocky places. Not that kind of rocky, but you know what I mean, okay? Sown in rocky places. Do you hear my mind just come sail away? Come. So you come to church any week and you can actually just kind of see it. And then it came back, okay. So it's sown in rocky places. They hear the word and they receive it with joy. Oh, Eric, that was such a great message today. You really shared God's word. I got it. But since they have no root, it lasts only a short time. When trouble or persecution comes because of the word, they quickly fall away. So when they begin to implement what they've learned and trouble, and this word trouble means pressure. Dum 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 dum. Right? You ever been under pressure? You ever feel like life's overwhelming? You ever feel like I just can't handle one more thing? That's what this is talking about. It's the idea that when trouble, when pressure comes. And then the second one says persecution. This word persecution literally means in the Greek, it's something pursuing you. They actually have done studies about stress. And did you know you release the same chemicals when you're under a lot of stress that you do if you were being chased by a bear? So I had one of the members bring a bear today. We're going to release it from the... Can you imagine? My life's a lot easier now after that bear illustration. So can we tune out? And here's what happens so often. A lot of our struggles are here, not really even out here. We don't literally have somebody pursuing us, but we feel that way. And so can we in those moments lift our problems to God? Can you take whatever problem you have and do what Johnny Lord taught me years ago, is take that problem and you take it to the Lord and you say, Lord, here it is, and you let it go. Now, if you're like me, can I tell you what I do with my problems? I have a prayer time and I can even use my mind and say, God, I'm bringing, maybe it's a person in my life. God, I'm bringing this person to you and I know they're struggling and I just give them to you, Lord. Oh, thank you for the peace that I have. Okay, Lord, I'll take that and I'll be walking around, right? Put whatever that problem is under my arm and carry it around the rest of the day. Hey, we've got to learn to just continually take it back to God. You know what, God? You're in charge. Number three, tune out selfish desires. Every fight you've ever had comes from selfishness. And of course, if you're like me, you think, yeah, there's selfishness, right? Yeah. So every fight you've ever had, every difficulty you've ever had with a person comes from selfishness. Listen to what happens here. Still others like seeds sown among thorns. Hear the word, but what happens? The worries of life, the deceitfulness, and that's the idea, the delusion of wealth. Like somehow wealth is going to bring you happiness. Okay? If that was true, Miley Cyrus would be happy. Amen. The delusion of wealth and the desire for other things. And by the way, we have media that tells us everything else will make you happy. If you get a new car, if you get a new this, if you get a new that, it'll all make you happy. Dave Ramsey coming up next month. Sign up. And choke out the word, making it unfruitful. So what happens? So you hear God's word, you read God's word in the Bible, you hear a good sermon, or God speaks to your heart, and what happens? Immediately you begin to think about you and your needs and your desires and the things that you want, and me. If only they would meet my needs, then I would be happy. If only you would do what I want you to do, then I would be happy. If only this situation would change, then I would be happy. And God says, hey, let the word sink in. And I want you to know something. You have time, long term, not short term, but you have time for the priorities in your life. And if something doesn't fit into your life, it's not because you don't have time. It's because you have not prioritized it. You've not put it higher on the list. Because let me tell you something. If tomorrow your water heater broke in your house, suddenly you would find time to do what it takes to fix that water heater and whatever it flooded. Number next. Oh, by the way, and here's a prayer you can pray for that. Lord, would you evaluate my priorities? Number four, take time to understand God's word and share. Others, like seeds sown on good soil, hear the word, accept it. It means let it sink in, and then it produces a crop 30, 60, 100 times what was sown. And here's what that's talking about. When we hear God's word and we let it sink in, it changes us, and that purpose of change is not just for us. The difficulty in so many churches today is there's people who've been going to church for years and years, and they come to church and they hear God's word and they say, wow, pastor, that was a great sermon, and they go home and they do nothing with it, and then the next week they come back and go, pastor, feed me some more, let me read God's word more, and they take it, but they don't do anything with it. The purpose of crops is to feed other people, and healthy plants give away their fruit. So if you have a tomato plant, when you pull the fruit, it actually makes the plant healthier. If you have a hedge and you actually cut off some of the flowers, it actually makes the plant healthier. It actually multiplies the plant as you prune it, as you take care of it. So here's what I'm saying. Some of you, today, you listen to God's Word. You know God's Word. You've studied the Bible. You know all about Scripture. Maybe you're watching online, and you've been in church for years and years hearing God's Word, and yet you still feel dry, or you still feel stale, or your Christian life has gotten just kind of eh. It could be because you're trying to keep all the fruit. And you need to begin to say, God, you've given me this area of my life. How do you want me to use it? God, how can I be a blessing to a neighbor or a friend or one of my kids? Or God, when you've shown me this about the poor, how can I be a blessing to the poor? How can I serve in my community? And allow God, as you read the Bible, to begin to say, God, would you help me to hear you and to know what to do? What do you want me to do next? Most people, Stephen Covey says, don't listen with the intent to understand. They listen with the intent to reply. You ever caught yourself doing that? You're listening to somebody, but they've finished their first sentence, and you're so busy thinking about your reply, you don't know their second sentence. This is where married couples get in trouble all the time. And it's funny because they come into my office, and they sit down, and they start to tell me a story, and the other couple goes, I didn't know, the other partner says, I didn't know that's what you were saying. And they interrupt them, by the way, usually to do that. And I instantly go, uh-oh, I know what happened. Somebody's not listening. Right? So here's what I want you to do this morning. We're going to talk about how can I tune out the noise to hear others. How can I tune out the noise to hear others? And I'm going to get to the point where I talk about how we can see others and love them. See others with the eyes of Christ. So I want you to take a moment right now, not look at anything else, and just say, look at your person next to you. Don't be too awkward. Don't stare at them. Okay? But just say good morning to the person next to you. Would you go ahead and do that right now? If you're watching online, good morning. Because you probably don't have anybody you're talking to. You're probably watching this on your phone in your bathroom. I feel awkward. Sorry. All right. So... I'm not going to read you the statistics about online stuff. All right, number one, take time for silence. Did I just say all that in church? Take time for silence. Come sail away, come sail away. All right, take time for silence and reflection. If I can do this, the most ADD person, well, not on earth, but pretty close. If I can take time for silence and reflection, you can. Get a piece of paper. Get a pencil or a pen. Get a notebook. Go up to Park Avenue in Titusville. Get a $29.59 book that you can spend time in prayer and journal a little bit when you're praying to help you to focus. Because even Jesus did that. Listen to Mark 1:35-37. Very early in the morning, while it was still dark, Jesus got up. He left the house and he went to a solitary place where he prayed. And by the way, what's getting ready to happen to Jesus is the same thing that happens to you. You sit down to pray. And all of a sudden, your thoughts are overwhelming. Your problems are overwhelming. Something you have to do runs into your mind. Same thing happened to Jesus. How do I know? Listen to the next sentence. Simon, who's Peter, and his companions went to look for him. And when they found him, they said, everyone's looking for you. Immediately, they said, what are you doing? Your priorities are wrong. But Jesus, even Jesus, took time to get still and get quiet and to pray. I know you're busy. My guess is Jesus was busier. I know you have a lot of pressure on you. My guess is Jesus had more pressure on him. So let's quit making excuses for why we can't. Let's quit thinking that we're so important that we can't take a few minutes out. And let's do the most important thing first. And spend time and let God speak to us. Say, God, is my heart right with you? God, is there anything you want to tell me? As we read God's word, to say, God, am I becoming less or more selfish? By the way, when you really read the Bible the way you're supposed to read the Bible, it should make you less selfish, not more religious. If you become more religious, you're reading it wrong. If you become less selfish and you care more for other people, you're starting to get the hang of it. The Holy Spirit is impacting you. By the way, scientists have done studies. Just 3 minutes of silence changes your blood pressure. 3 minutes. Some of you in the middle of your day should set a timer, 3 minutes, and go take a walk and breathe and pray. Number two, focus on living God's word. I kind of talked about this a minute, but it says this: whoever looks intently into the perfect law that gives freedom and continues in it. So it's the idea that you read the Bible or you hear a sermon in church or you hear God's word and it says they look into it, it gives freedom, and they continue in it, not forgetting what they've heard, will be blessed in what they do. So if you not only hear God, but you begin to take that fruit and you begin to say, God, how do you want to use this? Maybe God puts on your heart to serve in your community. Well, then you should go serve in your community. Maybe he puts on your heart to call somebody that you haven't seen in a while and check on them. Maybe he puts on your heart, you know, I know that person's been sick. I'm going to call them and just let them know I'm praying. I'm going to send them a Facebook note and let them know I'm praying for them. I'm going to take a moment to go by and see them. I'm going to go out of my way to do what God's called me to do. And when you do the Bible, that makes you unselfish. When you only listen to the Bible and let it make you fat, you become selfish. So do what the word says. Number three, this is so easy to say and so hard to do, and I'll give you an example. Don't focus on their circumstances or their abilities. I went out in my kayak 2 days ago when it was 104 degrees here. It was actually like 80. Okay, isn't that hard to believe? It was 80 degrees. Yesterday was like almost 80 in the morning, I think. But isn't that crazy how quick the temperature changed? But I was out on my boat. I have a little kayak, so I'm paddling out in the river. I don't paddle like this, I actually paddle like this. I was paddling, it looks really stupid though, I kind of like this better. Okay, so I'm out paddling in the river and just praying, and as I'm coming in, I knew about this sermon, I'd been thinking about the sermon. Coming in, I see this guy on the shore, shorts, flip-flops, smoking a cigarette. Now I'm from Miami, I tend to be a little leery of strangers. I actually was vacuuming my car the other day up in Titusville, was vacuuming, and the owner came up and walked up behind me and said, hey, and scared me, and I turned around to punch him in the face. And I punched the door because I saw it was him, and I punched the door and hurt my hand. And he's like, oh, I was just going to give you a token. So I punched him. No, just kidding. So he was being nice, but he scared the pajeebers out of me. Anyway, so I'm coming in, and so I'm a little leery, and I see this guy, and I'm thinking, is he going to try to rob me? You know, I've got my wallet with me, and, you know. So as I come up, I think, okay, Eric, let's focus on the person first. Even if I have to be a little cautious, I want to focus on the person first. So even if you're dealing with a homeless person, you can be cautious, but can you focus on them first? So, and then the guy I just had a conversation with him. I asked him where he's from, and he's from the area, and he was looking at my kayak, and he just thought it'd be really neat, and I talked to him about how I load it and unload it, and, you know, we just had a normal, everyday conversation. If you're going to be able to speak to people, you have to look past what they look like or their education or their experience, or even if they have an accent. Sometimes if we meet somebody and we think, wow, they seem real slow to me. Or we meet somebody and they have that Boston accent, we instantly think, that's the rudest person, right? Right? Isn't that funny? Because we kind of judge people instantly. Instead of doing that, why don't we do what Jesus did? So Jesus is coming into this town. There's this short tax collector named Zacchaeus, okay? And we don't know how short he was, but the average height back then was about 5'3", 5'2". I would have loved to be there. By the way, when I visited Taiwan, it was really cool to walk in crowds and be like, oh, this is how tall people feel. You can actually see past the crowd. It was awesome. Anyway, but Zacchaeus was that guy. He was like me now. And so he's in this community. Not only that, he's hated by the community because he's a tax collector and he's a traitor. He's a tax collector for the other side. And yet he is Jewish and yet he's a tax collector. People hate him. Nobody wants to be around him because he can walk up to you in public and go, hey, you owe your taxes. Well, I don't owe any taxes. I already paid. Oh, no, I forgot to tell you. I didn't tax your mule. What? Yeah. And so you didn't want to be around him. So you can imagine how rejected and hated he was. So he can't even get to the front of the line. So what does he do? He climbs a tree. He's desperate to see Jesus even in his misery. Jesus comes into town. He comes up to where Zacchaeus is, up in this sycamore tree. And Jesus looked up and said to him, Zacchaeus, come down immediately. And you know, Zacchaeus had to be thinking, what's the next sentence going to be? Is the next sentence going to be, you're a jerk, or I hate you, or whatever? No, no. Zacchaeus, I want to come eat with you. I want to come and spend time with you. Let me tell you something. No matter who you are, God wants to spend time with you, and he wants to give you that heart. Now, let me tell you what happens to us. This is what usually happens to people we know. We get aggravated, most likely, with people in our lives. If you're a teacher, there may be a student right now that you instantly see them and they aggravate you. You may be married to somebody. Please don't look at them right now. And you might be aggravated right now. You've gotten into a habit of being instantly aggravated with that person. Hey, let's do what Jesus did, especially in this next passage. He saw everyone as a person first. So if you have one of your children that aggravates you, can I encourage you? See them as a person first. Do you have a person at work that bothers you? See them as a person first. Do you have somebody you're married to that you're really struggling? Begin to say, God, give me your eyes to see that person the way you see them. And this is really true in this next passage. Number four, focus on looking and loving first. Now, this is a guy who we call the rich young ruler. He's a little arrogant. Basically, Jesus says, you know, follow the law. And the guy says, yeah, I obey all the laws, which, really? Teacher, he declares, I've kept all these since I was a boy. Jesus looked at him. Listen to this. Jesus looked at him and loved him. When somebody makes an arrogant statement for you, is your first response to love them? When somebody says something to you that's, there's no way that could be true. You are liar, right? It says Jesus looked at him and loved him. In the Greek, this is a really cool word because it means he loved him again. Some of you need that for your marriage. You've gotten to where they irritate you. And you need to just begin to pray, God, would you give me your eyes for that person? God, I've grown tired. I've grown tired of that person at my office or that person in my family or that person I have to deal with all the time. God, would you give me your eyes to look at them and love them fresh and new again? One thing you lack, he said, go sell everything you have and give to the poor and you'll have treasure in heaven. Then come follow me. The Bible says the man went away sad. Jesus knew that was going to happen, but the story starts out with Jesus still, knowing this guy was arrogant, knowing this guy was self-centered, knowing this guy loved money more than he would ever love anything else at that time, it says Jesus looked at him and loved him. Can you love somebody when all their priorities were wrong? When they say the wrong thing? When they do the wrong thing? When they act the wrong way, can you still love them? Now, I'm not saying to be a doormat. I'm not saying not to have boundaries. I'm not saying to let people hurt you. Please have boundaries and all that stuff. But can you love somebody even while giving them boundaries? Let me give you a few tips, and then I'm going to end with one story. Practical tips to better listening. Number one, take time to be still and reflect. I promise you, if you'll begin to spend time in prayer, that you'll find that you can listen to people in a better way. You'll find that as you spend time in prayer and you ask God to help you, that the Holy Spirit, when you're talking to people, will give you love for people that you don't even always like. Number two, ask God to remove selfish thinking through His Word. Most of the time when we're aggravated with people, it's because they're in our way. So let's begin to rethink our priorities. God, is that how you treated people? Number three, look others in the eyes and put down devices. Wouldn't that change our world? That would absolutely change our world if we could just put away our... Hey, even if you need to set a timer at the dinner table for 10 minutes and set that thing upside down, no one is going to die in those 10 minutes. Number four, ask God to help you empathize instead of answer. Can you feel what that person feels even if you think what they said was the dumbest thing you've ever heard? Can you feel what they felt? God, would you help me feel what they're feeling? I don't understand it. It doesn't make any sense. It seems dumb to me. I just want to tell them, suck it up, buttercup. I want to show them the video. Stop it. Right? But can I empathize with them? Can I really feel what they're feeling? And then number five, can I picture and repeat what they're saying? If you're really working on relationships, work on repeating. Okay, I think what you're saying is this. And then finally, ask questions. Ask questions. When you ask people questions, it shows you, if you want people to feel more important in your life, ask them questions. If you have a young person you don't know how to relate to, or somebody at work you don't know how to relate to, ask them questions. How was your week? And wait for them to answer. Listen to their answer. Ask them how they're doing. But too often, we're like the little boy who escaped from his parents. A famous psychologist walking in a park, and as they walked through the park, they turned around and their four-year-old boy was missing, and the mom lost her mind. Where is our boy? And she became frantic, and the dad said, I know exactly where he is. And she's like, what? She's like, follow me. So they walked back to the fountain, and the little boy was sitting next to the fountain. And the dad said to the mom, where's the one place you told him not to go? By the fountain. Well, I knew that's just where he would be. Listen, all of us know we need to listen. All of us know that we need to listen to God and put God first. But all this other stuff in life seems so important. All of this, there's only two commands. Love God and love people. And we struggle because we're so busy doing everything else. Hey, let's get away from the fountain and go to God and say, God, I want to spend time with you. And God, I don't even like this person very much. Can you help me to love them? Sometimes if we're honest, we look in the mirror and we go, God, that person's a failure. Would you help me to love them? And he will change through the Holy Spirit your love for you. And he'll change your love for people when you spend time tuning out the noise and allowing God to fill your heart with his word. If you're here today and you've never given your life to Jesus Christ, we're going to have our offering in just a minute, our time of giving. But if you're here and you've never given your life to Christ, today you have the opportunity. You can say, I want to give my life to Christ. I know about him, but I've never surrendered or I've never done it publicly. So you can come up after the service and say, Eric, I want to give my life to Christ. Or recently, I recommitted my life to Christ. Maybe you're here today and like me, you're a horrible listener. I want to encourage you, don't miss any of this series. And take this home, maybe take these notes home and look over it again during the week and remind yourself of what God's word says so that any of it that sailed away, you can ask God, God, would you help this to sink in and change my life? He will do it. Through his Holy Spirit, he can do miracles. We had a lady last night that had cancer, came up to me last night. We had been praying for her. She went in for surgery. They did the surgery. And here's what they said. No more cancer. God does miracles. Now, he does microwave some things in life like that. But most things in our lives are crock pot. So be patient. Let God work slow and deep in you day by day, knowing that he can do miracles, but sometimes he chooses to do them very slowly, okay? So let him work in your marriage. Let him work in your relationships. Let's pray. Father, thank you for this morning. I pray that you would do miracles in our families. Lord, I pray, I know there's homes here where there are kids who haven't talked to parents in years. There's parents who haven't talked to children in years. There are spouses who are struggling. And Father, I know that you can do absolute miracles as we learn to love. So help us, Father, through your word, to listen, to really love people with our time, but also with our vision, to learn to look at them and love them. Father, do a new work in our church. I pray that would be true as people come into church, that we wouldn't see people in our way, but we would see them as people that you love. Father, we invite you to work here. Father, I pray for anyone watching online that doesn't know you, that today they might surrender their life.